For 14 years, it has traveled the globe. In Paris, the legendary Dorothy Hamill won its first gold medal. With the palace guards looking on in London, Torval and Dean celebrated their final victory together. The cold Russian winter was warmed by the fire of Gordieva and Grinkov. Olympic sights, Olympic champions. The most celebrated cities in the world have hosted skating's greatest names, those who have elevated the sport and helped write history. This year, the championship returned home as Denise Beelman captured her fifth title and Paul Wiley said goodbye. A who's who list of the sport's finest professionals have again gone head to head in one of their most prestigious competitions. Now, their special performances are straight ahead. Welcome, everybody, to the Equal Challenge of Champions. Always an important date on the professional figure skating calendar. We are inside the Ice Palace in Tampa, Florida, along with Peggy Fleming and Dick Button. I'm Terry Gannon as we get set for the special performances. And on the ice first, Denise Beelman. When she captured her fifth win at this year's event, she called it her finest performance in a decade. It was a victory over a field that included Olympic champion Christy Yamaguchi.
And it wasn't that anybody else skated badly. She deserved it. She earned it.
And she stayed in great shape. She won the World Championships in 1981. And this is amazing. She has kept this perfection of triple jumps and pushing her limits artistically. I feel like we're in aerobics class here.
Every time you watch her, she makes you feel bad about the shape you're in, doesn't she?
By the way, this number was choreographed too by Robin Cousins.
I think he's real effective for Denise's number. This is a nice change for her.
Tattoo.
There's a shop right down the street.
The rest is not bad either, is it?
We'll be right back.
number.
The lady has energy and style. My God, there isn't a thing that she hasn't accomplished in the world of skating.
Time to catch your breath. Where's you out just watching Denise Beelman, the 1981 world champion.
Still going strong.
Much more to come from Tampa in the Equal Challenge of Champions. And hi, everybody, I'm Terry Gannon. Welcome to one of professional figure skating's most prestigious events.
One that, since 1985, has played some of the world's most exciting cities and featured skating's biggest stars.
This year is no exception. Those who made their names at Nationals, Worlds, and the Olympic Games and are now the leaders of the pro circuit offer up their special performances. And Peggy Fleming, there is only one goal here, to entertain all of us.
Well, that certainly is the case. You know, if you've ever been to an office party and seen a completely different side of your coworkers, well, that's what exhibitions are all about. It's an opportunity for skaters to lose their inhibitions and explore their personalities. It's also their time to focus on the audience and test the applause meter. But more importantly, it's a time when skaters can truly elevate our sport. And someone who has elevated our sport a lot in the last few years, well, maybe it was during the dark ages, our very own Dick Button.
Yeah, thank you very much for the compliment. I don't know about the dark ages, but I'll accept the compliment. Peggy, you know, it may be an office party for you, but for me, it's more like a smorgasbord of delectable appetizers. I mean, let me try this on you. How about that delicious souffle of a Katerina Gordieva and the lemon tart of a Christy Yamaguchi or the upside-down cake of a Gary Beacom? Now, Viktor Petrenko offers the fulfillment and surprise of Chicken Kiev. Remember, he's from the Ukraine. And Rudy Galindo brings the spice and zest of biting into a jalapeno pepper. And Paul Wiley offers the aristocratic taste of a little caviar on toast points. But me, I'm kind of a regular kind of guy, and I just think I'll have some pretzels and beer, put my feet up, and watch this here ice extravaganza.
Now that we're all hungry, the skating continues. Rene Rocha and Gorsa Sir about to take the ice here in Tampa with their special performance. Their partnership began in 1990 after Gorsa defected from the Soviet Union. They were not able to compete at the Olympic Games in the past because he did not have U.S. citizenship in time. But they have won two U.S. championships in 1993 and in 95. They finished in second place in this event here at the Ice Palace.
The music, perhaps, perhaps. He plays a nerd who wants to dance. She can't find anybody else, so she finally agrees. And then she can't get rid of him.
Hard to recognize Gorsa in this costume. You won't admit you love me, and so how am I ever to know? You only tell me perhaps, perhaps, perhaps. A million times I ask you, and then
I've noticed that they've had a lot of fun doing this program. Perhaps, perhaps, perhaps. I mean, it's the freedom that they have in this world of skating. They don't have to cringe under the confines of the rules of amateur ice dancing.
I know that guy from chemistry class. Say
yes, but if you don't, there always has to be one. Confess, and please don't tell me. Perhaps, perhaps, perhaps.
Perhaps, perhaps, perhaps.
Totally fun number.
I think he has a ball doing that. You know, it's been really fun seeing the two of them blossom. I mean, I think she's so much happier now that, you know, she has a freedom in her ice dancing and can do whatever makes them comfortable.
I mean, this number really worked for them.
And he's still in character. There's a good bet Gorsha Sir won't wear that jacket or those glasses outside of this performance, though, huh?
I don't think so.
The two-time U.S. ice dancing champions, Renee Rocha and Gorsha Sir. Well, it's been a Hollywood story with a happy ending for Rudy Galindo. He's emerged as one of the finest skaters in the world, much of the success due to his sister and coach, Laura.
Everything that she did, I thought was pretty cool. Then she started skating from a birthday party, and of course, whatever my sister had to do, I had to start too.
It was fun to have him tag along with me. It was. At times. At times, it was. Because that's all we knew was each other.
Rudy, Laura, and their brother George grew up in a trailer park in San Jose, surrounded by drugs and gangs. Their father, a truck driver, encouraged Rudy and Laura to skate. His absences and their mother's manic depressive disorder left a little girl to play mom.
She had to take over my mom's mental illness and her being whisked away to the hospital and us staying in Los Angeles with my aunt. But Laura felt that it was her duty to take care of me as a young child.
And still do.
And still do.
We take care of each other.
Yeah, we do take care of each other.
Eventually, the cost of supporting two careers on the ice became too great. Laura decided that she would be the one to give up skating. Rudy excelled on the ice. By age 13, he was already the men's national novice champion. And a year later, he also began to skate pairs with Christy Yamaguchi.
We went up the rankings so fast, and I thought, this is it. We're going to the Olympics, and this is what I want. So I gave up singles because it just made it easier to compete in all in pairs. And once that was taken away, it was really devastating to me, and that's when it started going downhill from there.
Rudy's misfortune spiraled. In 1989, Rudy and Christy's pairs coach, Jim Hulick, died of AIDS-related cancer. Then after 7 years together, Christy decided to focus solely on singles. Rudy slipped into a lonely place. Competition after competition, Laura paid for coaches, costumes, training, and Rudy faltered. And the pain would only grow. In 1993, Rudy's father died of a heart attack. The following year, Rudy lost both his brother George and his coach, Rick Inglese, to AIDS. With each loss on and off the ice, Rudy grew more bitter and said, enough.
I think he was sick and tired of himself, feeling sorry for himself. He wanted to grow up inside. He was, you know, took off that shell and said, this is who I am, and I'm going to do it myself and stop putting blame on people.
At the 1996 Nationals in his hometown of San Jose, Rudy decided to give skating one last try. He skated for himself, his family, and everyone he had lost. And he did it with Laura as his coach.
What Rudy needed from me was the emotional support, the love, and just the encouragement. He really needed someone to go, you could do it, and believe in himself. And I did believe in him.
The dark times were finally over. Rudy Galindo was a winner. Gold was followed by bronze at the World Championships, and now he has an illustrious pro career. Success has brought many rewards.
Now that I succeeded, it's all come back to me, and I've realized how much Laura has actually done for me. So now my role is to make sure that she's set and my mom's set for life.
Every time he takes the ice, you're taken back to that day in San Jose when he won the U.S. National Championship. And now, Rudy Galindo even more comfortable as a professional and paying back his sister for all of her sacrifices.
His tattoo on his shoulder is the name of his sister, Laura.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again, because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping, and the vision planted in my brain still remains. The sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked alone. Narrow streets of cobblestone. Neath the halo of a street lamp, I turned my collar to a cold and damp. People talking without speaking, people hearing without listening, people writing songs that voices never share. Said I, you do not know. Silence like a cancer grows.
Some stretch in that, isn't it?
Oh, beautiful.
Take my arms that I might meet you, but my words like silent raindrops fell. And the people bow and pray to the neon god they made. And the sign flashed out its warning in the words that it was forming. And the sign said the words of the prophets are written on the subway walls.
His childhood was not always a happy one. Adversity and hurdles that he had to cross are well documented, but it's interesting now that he is choosing music that brings back memories and thoughts of his childhood.
That sometimes is very valuable to do. I'm not sure that this particular piece helped him in creating an overall impression, an overall impact. Remember, you've got a very short period of time to create a whole theatrical picture.
It was a very mellow piece of music and very mellow choreography.
The special performance of the 1996 U.S. National Champion, Rudy Galindo. We continue from the Ice Palace in Tampa, Florida, with the pairs team of Radka Kvarkova and Renee Novotny from the Czech Republic. This is their third year competing as professional skaters. They captured the silver medal at the World Championships in 1992 and won the gold in 95. And here in Tampa for the second straight season, they finished second at the Equal Challenge of Champions.
Irish music can be very difficult to skate to. It has such a stomping kind of beat, a clog beat, so to speak. And skating is just the opposite, that when it works, it's wonderful to see.
It has a wonderful excitement.
The world keeps getting smaller. Pair from the Czech Republic, skating to Irish music.
In Tampa, Florida.
That's right.
And living in Lake Arrowhead, California, in real life.
Mm-hmm.
Very handsome couple on the ice.
She's a very elegant lady.
Riverdance comes to Tampa in the form of Renee Novotny and Rotka Kvarakova. Coming up next, the offbeat Gary Beacom. He has never followed the path of others, but now his unconventional ideas have landed him in the worst hot water of his life. The next year may be a long one. We'll have his story right after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Allenwood Low Security Federal Correctional Institution in Pennsylvania. For the next year and a half, Gary Beacom will be a prisoner here after being convicted on charges of income tax evasion.
I have a fundamental philosophical and difference with income tax. I believe that it's an invasion of privacy, and that it amounts to slavery, and that it crushes the human spirit.
When we recorded this program, Beacom had already been convicted and was awaiting sentencing. On January 5th, he was sent to prison for 21 months and fined $50,000. Beacom's trademark has always been originality and innovation. In a sport where most perfect their routines down to each movement of the hand, Beacom lets the music play and usually improvises.
Gary Beacom represents a facet of skating that is not often explored, and I think the value of his contribution to skating is quite high. I mean, it's the Dance Magazine called him the first postmodern skater.
Canadian-born Gary Beacom became a U.S. resident alien in 1991, which gave him the right to live and work permanently in this country and the responsibility to pay U.S. taxes. That same year, he and Gia Goudot moved to Sun Valley, Idaho, where they bought a house and together performed in lucrative tours. In 93, Beacom decided not to file a tax return and started a protest. Within a year, the IRS was investigating Gary's finances.
I personally never thought that he would win this fight, although he believes he's right, and he's willing to fight this to the end if he loses everything. If he loses his home, his career, his job, his friends, he's just the type of person that will stand up for what he believes in.
At his trial, Gary Beacom chose to represent himself. Court documents show Beacom's defense was based on his belief that income tax is unconstitutional. The jury sided with the U.S. Department of Justice, which argued Beacom made an economic decision not to file after his taxes increased 100-fold from 1990 to 91. Immediately upon sentencing, Beacom was taken into custody. And although they are no longer a couple, he phones Goudot from prison every day.
I'm surprised. He's very positive. I don't know if this is going to last. Definitely being confined and not eating what you want takes its toll. And I think it's just a matter of time till we really know how it's affecting him. But knowing him, he will make the most of it.
Beacom has not yet conceded his fight, and he has filed an appeal. If the appeal is denied, he still faces a civil trial against the IRS to determine his debt. He currently owes almost $200,000 in back taxes, and he faces deportation.
I think that this situation has all the elements of a Shakespearean tragedy. His greatest strengths have also become his greatest weaknesses. Taking things as far as he can go has made him a great skater, but it's also, in another situation, ended him up behind bars.
His story and his troubles a long way from being over, but after he was convicted and before sentencing, we got one last opportunity to watch Gary Beacom perform. And make no mistake, maybe away from the ice he should have drawn the line, but on it, he is as unconventional as ever, and there is nothing quite like a Gary Beacom performance.
The music is dancing. Composed and performed by Chris Isaac. The audience is getting into it already.
Yes.
see his feet are moving wonderfully. They, you know, he just does the reverse of what you expect. I mean, he's all about doing what's not expected.
Tell me, why don't you guide me? Why don't you promise?
Of course, you've got to expect that any skater that stands on his head on the ice, which he does quite frequently, you know, has got to see the world from a different point of view. Maybe that explains sometimes his very contrarian point of view. It's on a completely outside edge, and it's it falls rather from a standing spin into a sit spin. Now that's a strain in the position which far exceeds what some of the great skaters do in the form of sit spins. And another spin of totally reverse position. He's a skater like many, many modern dancers. He allows his body to fall, pulled by gravity, and then to check that fall and move into positions that are just off stream and off beat.
Well, Gary views himself as kind of a modern dancer. He's inspired by that.
Well, he is a modern dancer.
Yes.
Completely. Better yet, a modern ice dancer. And a rebel with a whole lot of causes.
I love his expressions that he gets on his face.
And sometimes even more compelling, the expressions of the audience members. They never quite know what to make of Gary Beacon. Well, his experiences away from the ice, much different these days. It'll be a tough year and a half ahead. We certainly wish him well. More from Tampa when we continue in a moment. And we continue with the special performances of the Equal Challenge of Champions with Yuka Sato of Japan. 24 years old, originally from Tokyo. He now lives and trains in Muncie, New York, the 1994 world champion. She finished in third place at this event in Tampa.
The music, Higher by Gloria Estefan. A little bit of angle to that.
Yes. She has a beautifully expressive face. She's very musical.
And then she turned away, so I said, "Hear me now. Just understand, don't get me
A little bit of franticness there,
yes,
isn't there?
A lot of energy going on.
Well, we're not in Miami, but we're not too far from it here in Tampa.
Very appropriate.
Luca Sato to the strains of Gloria Estefan. They're at the Equal World Challenge of Champions. And taking the ice next, the ice dance team of 28-year-old Amy Webster and 34-year-old Ron Cravette. Twice the bronze medalist at the U.S. National Championships. They made their competitive professional debut here in Tampa, finishing in third place. They're skating to Somewhere by Barbra Streisand.
Music is really very good for them. It really fills this whole arena. Of Bloomberg and Seberg, their edges and their flow over the ice. And I think this music is very good for them. It really fills this whole arena.
And their skating seems to fill the whole arena. They are big performers on the ice. Their style is very American in comparison to some of the Russian ice dancers that we had seen in the Olympics in the past few years.
Nice choice of music, beautifully choreographed routine, very refreshing.
It's a fun dance. Mm-hmm. Fun in the sense that it's relaxing and you enjoy watching it and you feel that you can do that yourself. Mm-hmm. So just stand up and let's go, Peggy.
KATHERINE HEALY was a gifted child. She was in figure skates before the age of 3 and ballet slippers soon after. living with her parents in Brooklyn. Her life grew into an after-school routine of skating lessons and ballet class. She excelled at both, but to be a champion, she had to place one pursuit above the rest.
It was difficult, but it was always pretty clear to me that I liked ballet better, that I didn't want to go to the Olympics, I wanted to dance.
She loved dance, but still Healy clung to skating. At age 10, she became the subject of a best-selling book entitled A Very Young Skater. At 11, she turned professional, and under the guidance of her hero, John Curry, she performed in figure skating shows, despite the strong disapproval of her ballet mentors. While a 12-year-old student at the School of American Ballet, Dudley Moore chose her to play his daughter, a young ballerina dying of cancer, in the movie 6 Weeks. At age 14, she won a gold medal at the International Junior Championships, the most prestigious ballet contest in the world. She was offered a principal contract in London, and at the age of 15, had her first taste of life as a prima ballerina.
You know, there was an awful lot of resentment. My peers, I had a senior principal contract, I was 15. My peers were 28 and 30 and 40. There was a lot of resentment.
After 2 years in London, Healy wanted to go home. Her next move scandalized the ballet establishment.
In 86, I was accepted to Princeton, Harvard, and Yale. All the ballet people figured if I went to college, I'd get fat and have a boyfriend, and that would be the end of me. And so it became a mission for me to finish college and to go back to being a principal dancer in a company.
The demands of Princeton and ballet training with a private teacher left no room for skating. When she finished her art history degree, Katherine took an offer from a European company and danced abroad for 7 years, immersing herself in the unforgiving world of ballet.
The German word for poison is gift. Some people might think my ability for dancing is a gift, and it was to an extent. Basically, ballet is not a job, it's a lifestyle. It poisons everything you do. You know, it governs what you eat, what you wear, what you say. It's political, it's mean, it's nasty. I took a great beating for a long time, and I ignored it because the trade-off for me was I wanted to dance, I wanted to perform, I wanted to be out there doing these beautiful roles.
After 6 years in Vienna, the pain started to outweigh the rewards. Although she had grown to dislike the lifestyle, the thought of life without ballet was frightening. She returned home and was drawn to the one place she'd always felt safe, the ice. One lesson with Peter Burrows, coach of national Paris champion Ina Ndungen, and she saw her future.
But we had this first lesson, and he said to me, hey, you should skate, you should do some shows.
That's great, Katherine, good.
And I thought, sure. I didn't think I'd have the nerve.
It wasn't only her dormant figure skating career that was ignited that January day with Burroughs. Only 5 months later, their relationship had become a romance.
He asked me out on a date in May, and we had a wonderful time. It was about 8 hours long, and the next day he said, will you come to dinner with me? And I said, yes. He asked me to marry him.
Burroughs and Healy married this past September, and Katherine resumed the professional figure skating career she'd begun at age 11. Healy now feels more alive than ever, as if she's been awakened from a bad dream, like the fairy tale princess she once portrayed.
I have a lot of freedom. I don't, you know, I'm not in a ballet company. People can't tell me what to do. You know, I skate, I put my number together, I do the choreography, or I choose the choreographer I want. It's like they let me out of prison for good behavior. I'm so happy.
From ballet slippers to ice skates, Katherine Healy thrilled to be back on the ice once again. She did not compete at this year's Equal Challenge of Champions, but the return of her figure skating career continues now with her special performance.
Well, I must say that she is just an extraordinary breath of fresh air in the world of skating today.
It's breathtaking to see her, her beautiful line.
She proves that the artistic side of skating can be superb. Any one of those moves worth any triple jump.
Prima ballerina Katherine Healy. Built to skate here in Tampa, Olympic champions Christy Yamaguchi and Victor Petrenko, along with the special performances of Ekaterina Gordieva and Paul Wiley. Much more to come from the Equal Challenge of Champions. And welcome back, everyone. The special performances of the Equal Challenge of Champions continue, an event that has spanned the globe in its 14 years of existence. We are inside the Ice Palace in Tampa, Florida, along with Peggy Fleming and Dick Button. I'm Terry Gannon. Next on the ice, Victor Petrenko and how his life has changed since a poor upbringing in Ukraine and then winning the 1992 Olympic gold medal. He and his wife, Nina, now proud parents of Victoria Viktorovna, who was born in July of this past season. Victor has won this event before. This year, he finished second.
Now, Victor Petrenko.
And he'll be skating to Parisian Walkways by Gary Moore. Supposed to be skating with a partner in this performance, and the red scarf represents that partner. Whom he says is his wife.
Part of this championship, he would have had a much higher standing.
He gets incredible height in all of his jumps. Lots of power and speed.
Victor won this event in 94, but placed second this season.
Looking back at those summer days that got so cold, yeah. Ooh, I could write you paragraphs about
yeah.
is such a dramatic and effective performer. I love seeing him do numbers like this.
If you can imagine his wife as the scarf, I think you understand exactly what he was telling you.
He says it's the happiest time in his life, and he's more relaxed than ever out on the ice. Victor Petrenko. And we turn our attention here in Tampa to Lloyd Eisler and Isabelle Brasseur, the five-time Canadian champions, who are the winners of this event in the Ice Palace this year, the 1993 World Champions, and their special performance.
And it's Bette Midler singing Miss Otis Regrets.
Oh, hi. Is Miss Otis in?
Miss Otis Regrets. She's unable to lunch today.
Humor that they do so well.
Watch this combination. I always wonder whether he's about to drop her there. That's a pretty jazzy butler, isn't it?
That's what skaters used to wear.
Yes, indeed.
In the old days.
I can attest to that.
Fun, a lot of energy.
The butler did it.
Right.
What a hand from this crowd.
Well, they have energy and excitement and a real athletic tone, a really athletic tone to their skating. And solid and good old moves.
The 1993 World Champions, Isabelle Brasseur and Lloyd Eisler. And when we come back to the Equal Challenge of Champions, the two-time Olympic and four-time World Paris champion, along with her husband, Sergei Grinkov, now on her own, Ekaterina Gordieva, takes the ice.
I remember the day he came to our farm, just before harvest time. He introduced himself. We talked some.
He told me about something that had never been done before.
How soybeans like mine were now being used for a new kind of cooking oil.
It seems the folks who made Crisco had come up with Olean, an oil that fries up snacks without adding any fat or calories. Make them taste specially good. So I told him, that sounds all right. And now I see what I'm part of, and it makes me feel good.
Coming soon from the makers of Crisco, new fat-free Olean, a good place to start.
For me, even a little foot odor is a big problem. But deodorizing insoles crowd my feet.
You need odor leaders for women with Arm & Hammer baking soda to stop odor. Plus a revolutionary tapered toeless design for comfort. Compare. Ordinary insoles fill the shoe from end to end, can crowd toes. But odor leaders for women cushion and support feet. No cramping, no crowding.
Fresh shoes and all the comfort I want.
These ordinary insoles can't do all that. There's nothing like odor leaders for women.
Sunday on the wonderful world of Disney.
Alaska's my destination.
You don't look the type, if I may say.
Oh, I am.
She set out in search of a fortune.
This is the promised land.
But what she discovered was the adventure of a lifetime.
If I can survive this, I can survive anything.
Alyssa Milano, Gold Rush, ABC Sunday at 7, 6 Central.
Jeff Gordon defends his NASCAR crown against a pack of drivers, including Daytona 500 winner Dale Earnhardt. It's the Prime Star 500, Sunday at 1 Eastern, 12 Pacific on ABC.
We continue with the special performances with that of Ekaterina Gordieva. She and Sergei Grinkov twice won the pairs competition at this event. She continues to define herself as a solo skier. She finished fourth at this year's competition with the ladies here in Tampa.
And her music, Bachiana by Villa-Lobos.
Sure is the vision of simple and pure elegance on the ice. It's a beautiful number for her. takes command of this music and the ice. There's hardly a bit of noise in this audience. You can hear a pin drop.
For a little wisp of a lady, she covers the ice with more speed and strength than anyone I've ever seen.
A respectful, appreciative hand from this crowd here in Tampa. The special performance of Ekaterina Gordieva. Still to come, the performance of the 1992 Olympic champion, Christy Yamaguchi, and the 92 Olympic silver medalist, Paul Wiley. That's straight ahead, right after this message and a word from our ABC station. Welcome back inside the Ice Palace to the Equal Challenge of Champions. The special performances continue with the Russian ice dancing team of Maya Usova and Alexander Zhulin.
Maya Usova and Alexander Zhulin.
This year they captured their second gold medal at this event. They were the 1993 world champions as well as the silver medalist at the 94 Olympics. Originally from Moscow, they now live and train in Simsbury, Connecticut. They'll skate to the music of Sting.
I think this number really shows their versatility. There's a lightness and a almost beyond ballroom dance quality to it.
But no matter what choreography they use, they never escape the world of ice dancing. They are pure ice dancers. They don't transcend this into any other event, such as pair skating or single skating. They are never not two skating as one.
And this control, this very difficult knee slide move.
La belle danse.
You kind of don't want to have them stop skating. They're so beautiful to watch.
If I were to ever write a book entitled The Joy of Ice Dancing, I would put their picture on the cover.
Married, divorced, retired at one point. The skating excellence continues for the 93 world champions, Maya Usova and Alexander Zhulin.
As the equal challenge of champions continues from Tampa, she's backstage getting ready right now, but Olympic gold medalist Christy Yamaguchi will be on the ice when we return. Christy Yamaguchi set to take the ice here in the Ice Palace in Tampa, Florida. She has twice won the gold medal at this event, but this season finished second behind Denise Spielman by the slimmest of margins. They had to go to the artistic marks to break the tiebreaker. Here she is with her special performance.
The music, I Have a Love, from West Side Story. Almost as though she flits over it.
I like seeing
like
the more
effervescent.
Yes, I love seeing the more emotional, expressive side of Christy. This number was choreographed by Michael Siebert.
I think
he's brought a nice quality out of it.
I think the music works for her.
Very much. This was a great number for Christy. Very pretty.
It's fun to see her. It's fun to see any skater when they mesh with their music.
She just seems to get better and better every time we see her. Christy Yamaguchi. And when we return, to the Ice Palace in Tampa, the man who has left an indelible mark on this sport and audiences everywhere. Paul Wiley captured his first win as a professional 6 years ago at the Equal Challenge of Champions. And fittingly, Wiley skated to victory in his farewell competitive performance at this year's event. When we come back, we'll take a look at a remarkable career and in the special performance of Paul Wiley. At 3 years old, Paul Wiley decided he wanted to skate. 1 year later, he saw a Harvard letter sweater and decided that's where he wanted to go to college. They would become the defining decisions of his life.
My parents were really supportive of me. I think it was hard on them because they knew the potential I had, but they knew that I had this burning desire to get through school. And so it was like I was juggling two things that didn't go together.
Harvard graduate, Olympic silver medalist, both describe Paul Wiley. But it's the combination of such facets that made him, and at the same time, almost broke him.
I think that people dismissed me for many reasons as an amateur, and none the least of which was the fact that I went to college. I mean, I think a lot of people said, well, he obviously is not really into it because he's taking on this full-time career in college. But I don't regret any part of it, but I think that being an amateur skater and going to college full-time is a difficult undertaking, and I just thought I was Superman, and I thought I could do it.
But many thought Paul couldn't do it. His performances at the Nationals were at times both dazzling and disappointing. He would have either a strong short or a clean long, but rarely both. Paul's coaches of 13 years, Evie and Mary Scottfold, believed in him regardless. Three silver medals and two bronze after 10 attempts at the Nationals should have garnered some respect, but the missing gold and the demands of education enabled some to discount him.
You go through so many disappointments, and you know, you have judges calling Evie and Mary and telling them that you should quit, and having people literally walk past you without speaking or seeing you and turning away backstage, and this happens, you know, kind of year after year after year. It was tough.
Paul's love for skating and the unwavering support from his coaches kept him going. Vindication came at the 1992 Olympic Games.
I really went into Albertville thinking that it'd be nice to place in the top five. But then once I got there, I was skating better than any American. And from that moment on, I had a hope of being on the podium, and that was really my goal.
If Paul Wiley only made a name for himself as an amateur, he certainly deserves a place in history as a professional. His unique intensity and ability to not just skate, but tell a story on the ice is his hallmark. The music, the events, the emotion. Whether it was JFK, Schindler's List, or Apollo 13, Paul has tried to do more than just perform.
I tried to depict the intensity of whatever it was, whether it was of the takeoff and then what it was like once you got into space, or whether that was the empty saddle or John saluting. There are some representative movements in the choreography which take small moments of that that I think about when I'm skating it, and that helped me to, I hope, evoke an emotion.
The ability to move an audience, Paul hopes, will be his legacy as he closes the competitive skating chapter of his life.
It is hard to say I'm going to, you know, not be here next year, because it's been such a great ride and it's been such a part of my life. But I would like for my skating to be remembered as a skating performance, but that didn't feel like one. That takes you out of yourself and causes you to be in touch with an emotion that you couldn't have expressed with words.
He told me he is in the moment about 90% of the time he is on the ice, to use an acting term. Every movement has meaning when Paul Wiley skates. 10 visits to the national championships, one Olympic silver medal, and fittingly, a win in his last pro competition here in Tampa.
And it's Touch Me by The Doors.
Very different kind of number for Paul.
cover a lot of territory in his skating. I mean, he has done many different kinds of programs with heavy music, light music, story music. He's a wonderful interpreter of dramatic music.
And this is a real diverse number for him. He looks relaxed and less intense, which most of his numbers have. It's nice and refreshing to see him like this.
He said he loves to perform this program. He's always been a big fan of the Doors. Get the Jim Morrison pants down.
I'm gonna love you till the heavens stop the rain. I'm gonna love you till the stars fall from the sky.
This program, choreographed by Laura Lubovitz. A lot of different moves for Wiley was not used to.
Very effective number.
The audience liked it, didn't they?
Very nice.
I think he does, too.
The Lizard King lives. Jim Morrison plays Tampa in the form of Paul Wiley. What a way to wrap up the special performances at the Equal Challenge of Champions. And a final look at the images left by the finest professional figure skaters in the world. And Dick Button, I'm Terry Gannon. That's all from Tampa. Right now, we take you back to Robin Roberts in our Wide World of Sports studios in New York.